Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the third Sunday after Epiphany, January 22nd, 2017. St. John's Lutheran Church is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has a food pantry every Wednesday, 9 o'clock to 10:45. A thrift store, open Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Friday, closed on Thursday from 9:30 to 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We have a rainbow table every Friday from 1 noon till 1. Everyone is welcome.
John's Lutheran Church, this is the service of the Word. This is January 22nd, 2017, the third Sunday after the Epiphany. This hymn is "Dearest Jesus at Your Word," written by Tobias Klauseneitzer, who lived 1619 to 1684. "Dearest Jesus at Your Word."
Across of your soul.
Connie Singleton will be doing the readings.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from Isaiah 9th chapter. There will be no gloom for those who are in anguish. In the former time, the Lord brought into contempt the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali. But in the latter time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased the joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Vicki Perks will be doing the Psalms.
St. John's Lutheran Church.
The Holy Gospel according He withdrew to Galilee. He left Nazareth and made his home in Capernaum by the sea, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali, so that what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. Land of Zebulun, land of Naphtali. On the road by the sea across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who sat in the region in shadow of death, light has dawned. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets, and he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Ask that you give your attention to God.
Thank you.
This time you may take out your sermon notes if you desire, which you will find in your bulletin. Follow along as we look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 12, ready to serve God. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. There was a little raggedy clad, starving boy on the street, crying and mumbling, "I'm hungry, I'm cold. I'm hungry, I'm cold." A man came up to him, a stranger, and said to him, "Do you believe that God will take care of your needs?" The little boy answered confidently, "Yes." So then the stranger said with a sneer, "Well, then why hasn't God sent someone to you in order to clothe you and feed you?" To which the little boy responded, "I know, sir, that God has asked someone to do it, but I guess that somebody has forgotten." I guess that somebody has forgotten. As brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, we are called to serve not just one another, not just our Lord Jesus Christ and His church, but we are called to serve all people, whether they are Christian or not. In our gospel lesson for today, St. Matthew mentions two servants of God, John the Baptist, who has been arrested, and our Lord Jesus Christ, who is now beginning His public ministry in full force. In verse 12, our sermon text for today, Matthew again writes, "Now when Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he withdrew to Galilee." From these words, we can learn some important lessons about being ready to serve God. In the first lesson we learn, and one that oftentimes is difficult for us to follow because of our enthusiasm of wanting to serve God, is that we must wait on God's time. And as we hear time and time again, God's time is not our time. As St. Peter reminds us in the second letter to God, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. And so what happens oftentimes with we Christians are that we feel God is calling us to do something, and we want to begin immediately. But it may not be God's wish that we start right now. He may want a few things to take place first. After Jesus was baptized by John in the Jordan River, we read that the Holy Spirit drove him into the wilderness. For 40 days and 40 nights, Jesus fasted and prayed. Then along comes Satan, tempting him to violate God's will, to offer Jesus all kinds of glory and power without having to go through the pain and suffering of the cross. But Jesus resists that temptation. And as he leaves the wilderness and comes back into Galilee, John is arrested. This is a sign to Jesus that now he is to go full bore into public ministry. You see, it would not have been possible for John to continue his ministry as the one preparing the way for the one who was to come, while Jesus was now on the scene. Some people would have seen them as competitors with one another, and so there would have been the division in the camps. So John had to decrease so that Jesus could increase. And so the arrest of John and his being thrown in the dungeon in the palace of Herod, King Herod, enables there to be no such competition and enables Jesus to increase. To Jesus to begin his public ministry, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, letting people know that the kingdom of God is near, to go about healing people and teaching them and raising the dead and revealing to the people and to us what God is really like. That God is this loving God who cares for us so much that he sent his only Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. So the imprisonment of John gives Jesus that signal to start. And the same is with us. As I said, sometimes Jesus calls us to serve him, but we want to jump in immediately. When I was in seminary, in the summer I worked at Osteen Children's Home. And there I met a fellow who was a couple years older than I was, who had entered seminary some years before me, but had dropped out and was working full-time at Osteen. Once I graduated from seminary and was ordained and received my first call, I later learned that he had gone back to seminary. And this time he did graduate and he was ordained, and he ended up having a very successful ministry up in Minnesota. So this was an example of where he had felt the call of Jesus to enter the ministry, but he was jumping in before Jesus was ready for him to start. And so his first adventure ended up not being pleasant, and so he dropped out. And then later, Jesus called him, and he's going through successful. Same thing happened with my ordination. I was supposed to graduate in the spring of 77. But instead, I decided to take some more courses, which meant I wouldn't graduate till December of 77. Well, my bishop was trying to arrange it so that I could be ordained in 77 with the rest of my class. But about November, he suddenly had a change in mind as to where he wanted to send me. And all the time up through November, he talked about not going to Richmond, Indiana. But then, in November, he decided to know where I needed to go was Evansville, Indiana. Which, for me, actually was an improvement because it was closer to Louisville than Richmond would have been. So, instead of being ordained in December, it carried over, first of all, because it was a bad storm in January, which shut a lot of Indiana and Kentucky and Ohio down. It was difficult to schedule the ordination until February 5th of 78. So again, God's time was different than my time. I wanted to be ordained before 77 ran out. God wanted me to wait and go to Evansville, and so I wasn't ordained until February of 78, as I said. So when God calls us to serve, we must also wait for his marching orders. Jesus Christ needs us to fulfill his great commission. He needs people to do ministry on his behalf, but we're not to jump the gun. We're to wait on God's time, not our time. The second lesson that we need to know in serving God is that we will face enemies. Enemies of God. Those enemies who do not want the gospel of Jesus Christ spread throughout the world. Those who, for whatever reason, whether they just don't believe in God or whether they have some kind of personal motive, there are those people who do not want the gospel being heard by others. And so just as Jesus faced opposition continually throughout his ministry, we will face opposition in our ministries. When Jesus calls us, we should not be surprised to be confronted by enemies. We should not be surprised that as we do God's will, instead of receiving a lot of plaudits and a lot of pats on the back about what a good job we're doing, instead what we will see is a path of serving God that is scattered with the bones of the martyrs, because they received that same type of opposition. The world needs the gospel of Jesus Christ. The world needs the ministry of Christ, the ministry of the church, but the world is going to resist. That cannot stop us. But instead, we, empowered by the Holy Spirit, move onward and forward for the cause of Christ. Many of you will remember the famous doctor and missionary and theologian, Dr. Albert Schweitzer, who gave up a promising career in Europe to spend his life in Africa helping the less fortunate. One year he was on leave or vacation for several weeks, and he went back to Europe and he made a tour of some of the universities in Europe speaking to the students. And at one university, there was a convocation in which he was speaking, and he said these words to the college students who were there. He said, quote, "I don't know what your destiny will be, but one thing I know, the only ones among you who will be really happy are those who have sought and found a way to serve." End of quote. The only ones who will be really happy are those who have sought and found a way to serve. Now that is a word that we don't hear a lot of these days. We don't hear a lot of people encouraging us to serve. Instead, we hear voices that tell us we should be looking out for number one. We hear a lot of voices telling us that we should hoard as much as we can, that we should grab all the gusto we can. We only go around once, so grab it all. That's the only place we hear the word serve is in the church and in the military. You turn on TV and you see every branch of the service with commercials encouraging young people to serve their nation by joining that particular military branch. Service. But outside of there, in the church, we don't hear that often from society. Because society looks only out for itself. Society, influenced by Satan, puts up his goals, being greedy, being nasty, not caring for those less fortunate. Step on as many people as you need to in order to make it to the top. Crush as many competitors as you can. That's the way to live. But Jesus is telling us that's not the way to live. He is telling us to serve. And by serving, we will face opposition. By serving, we will have people, no matter how, what good we're doing, no matter if it's helping all types of people, they will slam the door in our face or do everything they can to tear down what we've done. How many times do you pick up the newspaper or watch the news on TV and see where, in some country, a Christian mission has been destroyed by some group that hates a church, or some school, or some orphanage, or some hospital, or a well in a village has been damaged by those who hate the Lord Jesus Christ? It's to be expected. The world does not want to hear the good news of the gospel. But we are not to give up. We are not to be depressed. We're not to be disheartened. But instead, like those who have gone before us, empowered by the Holy Spirit, we continue to march onward and forward. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Christian's place is on the front lines, not on the sidelines. The Christian's responsibility is to serve, not to observe. Which brings us in to the third lesson we learn from today, for today, and that is we must be knowledgeable of Holy Scripture. Notice, not only did Jesus wait on God's time, but he knew the Scriptures and what the prophets had foretold. In verse 14, St. Matthew wrote, "So what had been spoken through the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled." If we are going to serve God, we must know what Jesus Christ revealed about God. That word fulfilled, or translated as fulfilled, literally means to complete something, to accomplish it, or to perform it fully. If we're going to serve God and complete what He wants us to do, to accomplish what He wants us to do, to perform our task fully, then we must know what Jesus commanded and what Jesus taught. We must follow God's will. Jesus, of course, being perfect, was able to fulfill God's will completely. That is why on that first Good Friday, with some of His last breaths, He was able to utter from the cross, "It is finished. It is accomplished. It is complete. I have performed fully what You expected of me." And with that, then He could say, "Father, into Your hands I commend my spirit." And He gave His spirit back to God and breathed His last. We are to work to fulfill whatever it is God has called us to do, to complete it, to accomplish it, to do it completely and fully. We must realize that we are carrying out God, Jesus' great commission, and that we are carrying out His teaching to love our neighbor as ourselves when we serve others. In order to not become despondent, in order not to be in despair, we have to know that what Jesus taught us was the first thing is to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind. Second, to love our neighbor as ourself. And then that new commandment that He gave us in the night of His betrayal in the upper room, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you." That is, that we, brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, are to have that same sacrificial, self-giving love towards one another that Jesus has towards us in the world. As He was willing to empty Himself out totally and completely, we are to be willing to do that for our brothers and sisters in Christ as well, instead of looking out only for ourselves. When we know what Christ commanded, when we know what Christ taught, then we can serve Him and have that fulfillment in that serving, no matter what our condition might be. With the knowledge that we are fulfilling the command of Christ, we will not be bogged down by jealousy, envy, or strife because someone seems to have more talents or more ability or more success than we do. Because if we know what Jesus has said, then we know that it is from Jesus that comes the call and comes the abilities to fulfill that call. If we know what Jesus taught, we know that the Holy Spirit, spiritual gifts are given for the glory of God and the work of Jesus Christ, but everyone does not receive the same gifts. If everyone had the same gifts, then many areas would be left unattended. And so we have to have different spiritual gifts. We can't all have the same thing. Just like our bodies. How difficult life would be if all we had was arms. We had no legs. How difficult it would be if we had just legs and no arms. How difficult it would be if we couldn't see, or we couldn't hear, or we couldn't talk. So just like we need different parts of our body in order to function properly, the church needs different gifts. So if we know that Jesus gives different gifts to the Holy Spirit, we then will not be jealous or envious or cause strife in the community of faith because what we have is different from what somebody else has. Instead, peace should reign. So we all work for Jesus Christ. We all work for the church. We all work to serve God's creation so that they may know of the light of Jesus Christ. A native Australian preacher went into a little church in the bush in order to conduct a Sunday evening service. It was dusk by the time he arrived, and as he entered the little chapel, he looked around and saw there were no lights. He wondered how in the world were they going to be able to see during the service because darkness was rapidly falling upon them. As he looked out the front door of the church, suddenly he saw all these little lights, almost like fireflies, moving around. It was his congregation coming to worship. Each person held a hurricane light in their hand. And as they entered the chapel, they would go to a wall, and all the walls of the chapel had a shelf on them. And they would place their hurricane lamp upon that shelf, for there was an open spot. By the time everyone had arrived, the entire church was illuminated by their lights. Each person had contributed light that had dispelled the darkness. Each Christian is that light that dispels the darkness for those who have yet to accept that light of Jesus Christ. For the darkness of disbelief, for unbelief, for the darkness of false religions to be dispelled or dispersed, we have to be that light that shows Jesus Christ as the way, the truth, and the life. We have to be that light that shows that Jesus is the true life, the true one to follow. If we hide our light, then the gospel does not illuminate, and people continue to live in darkness. Our contribution to a world desperately in need is the illumination of the gospel. We must take up the call, and we must be ready to serve God each and every day. For remember, God has called us to play the game, not to keep the score. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Let us now sing, "There Will Be Showers of Blessing," which is printed on the back of your book. There shall be showers of blessing.
Hymn, "There Will Be Showers of Blessing," was a hymn that was used by a prisoner of war in Vietnam. Major Daniel Whittle was the author of this hymn, but Howard Rutledge's plane was shot down and he memorized this hymn. This kept him alive in Vietnam. "There Shall Be Showers of Blessing."
Thank you.
please turn to page 105 in the front of your worship book? And again, I thought those who can do so without difficulty, to please stand. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray that the dawn from on high will shine for the church, the world, and all those in need. Our response today is, hear us, we pray. That our unity in Christ may lead all Christians to unity at the Lord's table and in mission and ministry to the world. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. That nations, peoples, and homes shadowed by conflict and violence may come to reconciliation and the dawn of peace. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. That all who live with grief, anxiety, loneliness, or illness may find hope in the wisdom of the cross. God of light and life, hear us,
we pray.
That we may proclaim the nearness of Christ's rule by promoting health and healing in our communities. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
That our congregation with its diverse gifts may offer hospitality to those of other faith, those who doubt, and those who differ from us. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
In thanksgiving for the saints united with us through our baptism into Christ, that we may be brought with him to your land of glory, God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
God of splendor and light, hear our prayers and illumine us with the radiance of your glory, shown in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
Now time for our offering. Our ushers are Sharon Leach and Helen Wallace. This is the 22nd of January, 2017. We are called here to serve God, to love one another. This is the word Jesus has asked us to learn, his word, the word of God. We've studied it today as we are here today to worship God. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We are following Christ. We're bringing his gospel of servant, suffering servant, to us. Today, the flowers on the chancel stand are given to the glory of God, presented by Anonymous to the glory of God, and also by Becky Dimitroff in the memory of Dolores Mittman's birthday. Wonderful Christian woman here at St. John's Lutheran. We remember her every day. Her spirit is with us. Two or three are gathered together in his name, and he is with us. The Becky Dimitroff has given the flowers in memory of Dolores Mittman's birthday today. We thank you that we are allowed to worship God here. We're to serve him. We're to love God. We're to love one another. We've had wonderful hymns today. Dearest Jesus, at your word. We've had the Kyrie asking God to have mercy on us, the Lord to have mercy on us. We prayed the prayer of the day. If you listen to the first reading, the psalmody, second reading, the gospel acclamation, the holy gospel, and the hymn we sang was, "There shall be showers of blessings." This was an inspiration to a prisoner of war in Vietnam who remembered this from his childhood and kept him alive for 7 years in a prison camp. "There shall be showers of blessing." And this can keep us alive today. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, come worship with us anytime. Ask Jesus to come into your heart.
personal moment for a minute. In the three churches I served before, always had one pastor in the group that I was serving with that always became my best friend and I was very close to. So then I came here to St. John's and of course met all the pastors who were here, and I developed a friendship with one pastor. We became quite close, but this time instead of being a man, it was a woman, and she is here today. She's worshiped with us before, but I want to again recognize my good friend, the one who's had my back these almost 17 years. We have filled in for each other when we go on vacation, and unfortunately, she decided to retire. Not unfortunately for her, but for me, she decided to retire in November. But let us please give a warm welcome to Pastor Carol Gessen. The nice thing about this is, since she's retired, she can't do this to me if I go visit Finn. Welcome, and thank you for all your support all these years. We meet every other Tuesday, it used to be every Tuesday, to just talk and study and just see how each other's doing. So it's good to have Carol with us.
Talk about our grandchildren.
Again, I'd like those who can do so without difficulty to please stand. As with gathered by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep you, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our worship with I Love to Tell the Story, hymn number 661 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 661.
This hymn was written by Catherine Hankey in 1866. Catherine Hankey worked her whole life to be a servant to God. She worked to eradicate slavery from the British Empire. She expanded the missionary efforts overseas. She led a Bible study for factory girls in England. She listened to God's call. I love to tell the story, Catherine Hankey.
Thank you.
to Catherine Hankey, the wonderful hymn that she wrote, I Love to Tell the Story. She worked in England to eradicate slavery. She worked with her sisters to overcome adversity, to follow God's will, to establish foreign missions. She worked with evangelism. We're very thankful to Catherine Hankey and all of the work that she has done and the hymn that she left behind for us to inspire us. I love to tell the story. Thank you for watching St. John's on YouTube. Tune in anytime. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church offers services on 8 o'clock Sunday morning, and we have 10:30. We have Sunday school at 9:15. We invite you to come, ask Jesus to come into your heart. We need the great revival. We need God with us. We need to experience His presence with us. As He has forgiven us of our sins, we are forgiven of sins, and we are to serve Him as Jesus Christ has called us. I hope and I pray that God will continue to bless you and keep you this day and all your days. We will pray for you, continue to pray for us and our YouTube ministry. Come worship with us, invite Jesus to come into your heart. Our lives are worth nothing without God.